Hey everybody, it's Jim of Animated Educated, and today we're going to watch another Disney family album. This one is featuring Ollie Johnston, yes, one of the nine old men of Disney, and also the writing partner of Disney's Illusion of Life book with Frank Thomas. And so this is the one about Ollie Johnston, which is pretty interesting. So let's take a look.
Animation. It's a magical illusion of seeing life in a lifeless object. For Ollie Johnston, the illusion of life is best illustrated by the engine that pulls his backyard model train.
The engine on a steam engine is more human than any other type of engine because it's all on the outside where you can see it working, and the sounds are more human. This panting and the wheezing and the steam exhausting and the smoke puffing. There's something about it that's romantic and fascinating.
A pencil and paper with no life of their own came to life with the talent and emotions of Ollie Johnston. Came to life as a bumbling pirate.
I'll tell the crew and...
As Alice in Wonderland.
Goodness!
As a less than aeronautical albatross.
Mayday! Mayday!
Just because they're a bunch of mere pencil drawings going through these routines and giving these performances, to me that was real. And I think that that was the type of thing that really interested me, because I like to watch people, and I was interested in how they moved and how they acted, and I was interested in their emotions. That's what Walt wanted. He wanted the emotions. The heart and soul of his pictures were the emotions.
Besides, you broke your mother's mirror. Oh,
mommy. For 40 years, Ollie Johnston created animation, The Gift of Life, for the Disney Studio. This is his story in the Disney Family Album. Growing up in Palo Alto, California, Ollie Johnston knew he was on the right track when he was drawing.
Tell you the truth, I can't remember the first drawing I ever made, but I know I started when I was, in kindergarten. Like most people who like to draw, I drew all my life, all through high school, generally drawing when I wasn't supposed to be.
As a student at Stanford University, Ollie found a way to combine his love of drawing with his love of sports.
These were caricatures of a football team that we had. I was a manager, one of the managers of the team, and I also covered the sport of football in the Stanford paper. I used to love to go see the Disney pictures. A bunch of us from school would go down to the town theater and just kill ourselves laughing at them.
Studying magazine illustration, Ollie learned the principle of giving his artwork emotional life.
You know, an illustrator has to portray the characters in a way that interests the reader in reading that particular story. And the way they do it is through showing the emotions of the character and the mood of the story in the illustrations.
Although Ollie considered a practical career in journalism, he couldn't shake his unprofitable passion for art.
Art was what I really liked. And of course people said, well gee, you'll be living in an attic on bread ends and carrot tops. Artists can't make any money. This was in the middle of the Depression, you know.
In 1935, the unemployed art student became an employed assistant animator at Walt Disney Productions.
But still, when I went out there, I wasn't sure that I wanted to be an animator. I thought, maybe I'll still be an illustrator.
Walt Disney had other plans for Ollie. He assigned him to an apprenticeship under Freddie Moore, one of the studio's star animators. Moore was in the midst of a masterful performance, creating seven unique characters for Disney's breakthrough film, Snow White and the Seven Dwarfs.
Well, it only took about 2 or 3 weeks to hook me. I could see that, gee, this is just the kind of thing. Here you can bring this character to life. Well, these are just frozen on the paper. But these other characters, they can move and they can express their feelings and their emotions and their thoughts. And to me, that was wonderful. And while somebody else might be more interested in the drawing of the character in that situation, I was particularly interested in how that character actually felt.
Ollie's feelings were right in tune with the boss's.
Right from the start, you could begin to see how Walt was getting these little personality touches in the characters, which would express how they felt. Whether it was a little shrug or an embarrassed smile or whatever it was, it began to tell you what the inner feelings of that character were. And so all through that, I suddenly realized, gee, this medium is the greatest in the world. This is a new great art form.
Ollie's intuition was right. Snow White and the Seven Dwarfs awakened the world to a stunning new art form.
Walt had told me after I finished Snow White doing the cleanups for Fred Moore on Snow White that I could animate. So the first picture I got onto was A Brave Little Tailor. And the first scenes I got were all crowd scenes. But you'd have thought that I was working on the best known characters in the world, and that each one of these characters had a personality that you can't believe. And I just really poured myself into it. And of course, at first I made them move too much all over the screen while they're talking. But gradually I calmed it down with Freddie Moore's help. And so it looks okay now, but it's nothing I'd write home about.
Ollie's first big break came on Pinocchio. He was one of the four animators assigned to the title character, and his unique talent for identifying with his character's feelings gave audiences one of the most memorable scenes in Disney animation.
Well, the big thing that I was trying to convey in the section where Pinocchio's nose is growing was the fact that here's this little guy who's just been brought to life at the age of about 8 or 9 years old, and he doesn't know a darn thing. And here he is caught in his cage, and here the blue fairy shows up and wants to know what happened, how he got in there, and here he's all embarrassed about it and twiddling his pants. He's afraid to face her. He knows he's done wrong, but he really doesn't know why or anything like that. And then he just keeps lying and making it worse, and he's sorry that he does this. And so all these are emotions that you can identify with.
My nose! What's happened?
Perhaps you haven't been telling the truth, Pinocchio.
Perhaps.
Oh, but I have. Every single word. Oh, please help me. I'm awful sorry.
Well, I'll forgive you this once. But remember, a boy who won't be good might just as well be made of wood.
We'll be good, won't we?
Gee, I really loved that picture because that was my first feature, and I believed in the picture. You know, that's the thing about the pictures that Walt made. I believed it, and I think that that's what made them great, the fact the animators believed so thoroughly in them.
Gee, look, Jiminy, my nose!
Ollie's next challenge came on Bambi. The little deer had to have the same newborn quality he gave Pinocchio, but here was a real creature that had to move as Mother Nature dictated. Again, Ollie searched for and found the feeling that everyone could identify with.
Feeling of Bambi being real innocent and all that, and seeing things for the first time. Gee, he's just barely able to walk, and I have a couple of scenes where he actually fell down, I think. But it was all new to him. A new experience, like a little baby seeing something for the first time. And he meets all the animals, and he meets the little mole who pops up and says, nice sunny day. And I always liked that scene.
Good morning. Nice sunny day.
I did stuff where he talks with Thumper, and Thumper's tells him, no, no, don't eat that green stuff, just eat the blossoms.
No, no, not that green stuff. Just eat
blossoms. That's the good stuff.
Thumper?
Yes, Mama.
What did your father tell you?
About what?
About eating the blossoms and leaving the greens.
Oh, that one. Eating greens is a special treat. It makes long ears and great big feet. But it sure is awful stuff to eat.
And that became a kind of a running gag, with Thumper always saying the first thing that popped into his head, and made that was part of what made his character so good, besides the great voice.
As an illustrator, Ollie liked to draw beautiful girls. As an animator, he brought those girls to life in Fantasia.
I enjoyed drawing the girls, and I think they came out pretty good. And I did most of the close-up stuff on the girls where the Cupids were making the hats. And the big challenge there wasn't so much of any emotion in that particular thing. It was more the entertainment that you could get out of watching something being made. I enjoyed characters more like the little reason and emotion character, the little girl who was so flamboyant and so impulsive and wanted to do everything that popped into her mind. If she'd see something to eat, that's what she wanted right away. She couldn't control herself.
A club sandwich with potato salad.
But I insist. Tea and
a four-decker club sandwich with cheese and ham and tuna and chicken and mayonnaise.
No.
We got chocolate ice cream with whipped cream on top of the cherry.
Remember, we're on a diet, please.
And for dessert, I'll have chocolate layer cake with fudge icing.
Oh, dear, we shouldn't go.
Cherries on top.
And here again you have the evidence that uncontrolled emotion can cause you a lot of trouble.
The most famous of Ollie's girls also caused him the most trouble.
Nothing made too much sense for Alice in Alice in Wonderland. Every character she met had some strange attitude that she was in conflict with all the time. This is a scene of Alice that I did in the section where she's talking to the doorknob. And she's very exasperated here in this particular scene. But you can also see how confining the drawings are. They have to be so accurate, because everybody knows what a real girl looks like.
Oh, no use. I forgot to tell you. I'm locked.
Oh, no.
But, of course, you've got the key, so...
Okay.
Now, don't tell me you left it up there.
Ollie's flair for animating the fair sex landed him a triple assignment in Sleeping Beauty. Flora, Fauna, and Merriweather.
At first, when we started on them, Walt thought, gee, why do we have to make these characters different, you know? Why can't they all be the same, react the same? We thought, oh, no. See, that wouldn't be half as much fun, you know, making them like Donald's nephews or something. So that was one time when we kind of went against what Walt had suggested. But I think it did make the picture richer to have them that way. Little Merriweather was a feisty little thing that'd get upset real easy. Fauna was always the one trying to say pour oil on troubled waters to keep peace between Flora and Merriweather. Because Flora was not what you'd call an appointed leader. She just automatically sort of became the leader because she had the best ideas. But all in all, the three of them formed a happy team.
I'll turn her into a flower.
Maleficent?
No, dear. The princess.
Oh, she'd make a lovely flower.
Don't you see? A flower can't prick its finger.
It hasn't any.
No, that's right. She'll be perfectly safe.
Until Maleficent sends a frost.
Yes. Oh, dear.
She always ruins your nicest flowers.
Ollie's favorite triangle of characters sprang up from the Song of the South. Brer Rabbit, Brer Bear, and Brer Fox were an animator's delight.
Song of the South had great characters and great voices. The fox in particular was a real rich character. He was so sure of himself and so sure of what he wanted, but he had this one weakness that he would always fall for any ruse that the rabbit had. The fox kept catching him, and then the rabbit would somehow trick him and get out. And the rabbit could usually get the bear involved on his side, and he was always able to use him in escaping. So he had a wonderful triangle there.
What you doing up there?
Oh, keeping the crows out the cornfield. I's making a dollar a minute.
A dollar a minute?
Indeed I is. Would you like to make a dollar a minute, Rose?
Thank you, Brother Rabbit.
That's all right. So long, Brother
Rabbit. I'll never forget this.
Yeah, goodbye.
I just don't know how to thank you.
Yeah, well, goodbye.
In Robin Hood, Ollie animated the hilariously unequal relationship between ruler and ruled.
Prince John was a very egotistical guy, but also very insecure. So he had a lot of emotional qualities that you were involved in handling him. And he had this sycophant of a counselor, Sir Hiss, who really had no choice but to stay with this guy because nobody else, who else would have him? So he became kind of sympathetic, and it was partly due to the great delivery on Terry Thomas, who gave him this kind of mincing quality. And also we used that gap in the teeth that Terry Thomas has to let the little tongue dart through. But that was a pair that you won't often get to animate.
Enough! Yes, you deliberately dodged.
But, sire, please.
Stop sniveling and hold still.
Thank you, sire.
Another comic foil Ollie brought to life was Captain Hook's bumbling first mate, Mr. Smee.
Walt put me on Mr. Smee on Peter Pan, and I was real happy with that. He's one of my favorite characters, and I guess, in fact, I looked a little like him, or he looked a little like me, because he was bald-headed, made it more fun. And he was a kind of a foil for Captain Hook. And if Hook wanted something to happen, he knew that he could get Smee to make it happen just by saying the right thing. And so he's trying here to get information out of Tinkerbell, and he uses Mr. Smee to help him get that information.
That's it, Smee! We'll Shanghai Wendy.
Shanghai Wendy, Captain?
Take her to sea with us. With her gone, Peter will soon forget this mad infatuation. Come, Smee. We must leave immediately. Surround Peter's home.
But, Captain, we don't know where Peter Pan lives.
Great Scott, you're right, Smee. What's that, my dear? You could show us the way? Why, I never thought of that.
Take this down, Smee.
Take this down, Smee.
Mr. Smee wasn't Ollie's only cartoon look-alike. In The Rescuers, he not only gave Rufus the Cat his good looks, he also gave him more than a touch of that Johnston charm.
I had a scene in The Rescuers where Penny carries the cat out to go to supper. And she could have just walked out and had the cat follow her, but I wanted to show how much she liked the cat, how affectionate she felt, and how the cat felt about her. So I had her pick the cat up in a way, really, that practically strangles the cat. But he loves her so much, he doesn't want to say anything about it. And she starts walking with him, and he starts to slip, and she has to boost him up. And it's much easier to do a walk like that than it is just a regular walk, where she has something definite she's trying to express, some emotional state.
Ollie's characters never took a step without betraying their emotions.
The prosecutor in Mr. Toad was a real keen character to do. He didn't have much footage in the picture, but what he did have had a lot of interest to it. He was a real egotistical guy who had contempt for any of the witnesses that were in the box, and he would strut across the days like this and whirl around on the witness like that to frighten him.
The witness may testify in his own words.
Right-o, Governor. Now I'll give you the facts of the case. For when...
Mr. McBadger testified that his allowance was cut off. Then how did he get a motor car?
The only way a gentleman gets anything. The honest way.
And what is the honest way?
Ha-ha, I thought you wouldn't know that, Governor.
Your lordship, I...
At the height of his career, Ollie was given the rare opportunity to soar above the boundaries of animation. For The Rescuers, he designed an entire sequence and its star character. But first, he had to cast the right bird.
So I kept thinking about it and thinking of the... that nature stuff on the albatross had some funny stuff, but I didn't really know what I was going to do. And finally, I came up with this idea for a personality, which was based on the fact that he was such an incompetent flyer, and yet gave the impression that he was the world's greatest.
Are you hurt, sir?
Nope. One of my better landings, bud.
Then when he started to take off was where I really had the problems trying to figure out what to do, because there was so much keen live action there where he's running along and he'd often abort the flight, just run out into the water and Zoda say, yeah, I can do this tomorrow, why bother now? And that worked pretty good, but I felt, gee, there's still something wrong here. This isn't as funny as it ought to be. And so I thought, this guy ought to be panting. He ought to be having trouble, so we put in this after the first few steps, and that started to liven it up. And I thought, another thing that ought to go in there would be that you hear his feet clomping down the top of the building. So we put that in, and then it really became funny.
A scene without movement is an animator's nightmare. But Ollie found a way to turn a nightmare into a thing of beauty in 101 Dalmatians.
Perdita, the female dog, the mother, is back under the stove. She's worried about her puppies. And it makes a difficult situation for the animator because Pongo, the father dog, has to squeeze in under the stove, and neither one of them can really move much. But as I worked on it, I realized that was really the best thing, and it was a challenge to make it come off that way.
Oh, Pongo. I was so happy at first, but now I wish we weren't having any.
Since the birth of Mickey Mouse, Disney Animation has had a universal appeal because the characters display emotions in a way that everyone can understand.
I think that most people who went to one of our pictures always hoped to be entertained with a lot of good laughs and everything. But the big thing was that we did a lot of it in pantomime and in acting that didn't really depend on dialogue. Take Dopey, for instance. He was probably the most popular character we've ever done, best known outside of Mickey Mouse. And he never spoke a word, but he had an appealing personality, childlike, but it was all done through pantomime. As Marcel Marceau, the great mime, said, the humor in a situation depends upon the personality of the character involved in the gag. And Walt found that himself after years experimenting, that was exactly the way he would approach things. And Walt himself was really a great actor and a great storyteller. And he would get up in the meetings very spontaneous, it was nothing planned, and say, well, here's how I think it ought to be. And I remember on Jungle Book, he gave the whole key to the way the Baloo character ought to be. By just a little thing he did, he says, you ought to get Phil Harris to do that voice for Baloo. He said, he's always doing this kind of stuff, where he's snapping his fingers and jogging up and down, always working to the beat. And so that really proved to be the key thing to that character. From then on, wherever we could, we had him working to music and to beat.
Look for the bare necessities, the simple bare necessities. Forget about your worries and your strife. I mean the bare necessities are Mother Nature's recipes that bring the bare necessities of life. Wherever I
It was during the production of The Jungle Book that Ollie had his last meeting with the boss.
After the meeting was concluded, we talked to him a little bit. We knew that he was going into the hospital, and we thought it was about an old polo injury he'd had in his neck. And so we asked him if he was worried about it, and he says, "You're darn right I am." And that was the last meeting we had with him, and just a few weeks later, he was gone.
Soon after, the completed Jungle Book was screened, and studio nurse Hazel George shared her feelings with Ollie.
She was a friend to everybody in the studio, and she had this way of talking about Walt. She said, "Walt wasn't a man, he was a force of nature." And that's about it, too. But anyway, she said, in that last scene that I did where Baloo and Bagheera dance off into the sunset, she says, "You know, that's just the way Walt went off. He went off into the sunset, just like that, and there he's gone."
Disney animation lives on, and we have artists like Ollie Johnston to thank for that. Ollie Johnston's own life became the inspiration and the soul of every character he animated. Thanks to Ollie Johnston, they create the illusion of life itself.
Well, there you have it. That's all about Ollie Johnston. And he was a really great animator. And he also was a great educator because he's, along with Frank Thomas, wrote The Illusion of Life. And they, educated another generation about 2D animation and how to take the principles of animation and apply them to CG and other art forms as well. So anyway, hope you enjoyed that. And if you did, you can press that little button right there. Yeah, that'll subscribe you to this channel. And if you want to, you can scroll down and you see other interviews and things like that. Or you can take a look at these two videos here. And we'll see you next time on Animated Educated.